neighbors might not appreciate it too much.
Let's say, Mr. Anderson.
No, great. Thanks for having me, guys.
No problem.
No problem. For joining us, Under the Mat Radio. We're not new to interviewing big stars, but this is new for us doing Skype. So you're our second edition Skype interview, but you're our first wrestler we've had so far on our Skype account. So we thank you for being the first.
Thank you.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you. So, you know, I do a podcast myself, but I've never done the video aspect of it. I like to sit around in my underwear and do my podcast.
So it's always good. They can't see you, but they can hear you. So
exactly.
We've all done that before. Like I said, Mr. Anderson, we got you on there live. We have a good number of things to cover. You are talking to us from Australia. So yes. We wanted to give you a chance to go ahead, let us know if you want to, what your business is in Australia, if it's business related.
Yeah, it's business and pleasure. My girlfriend lives here. So she's an Aussie, and I come down here pretty regularly to do independent shows. So I had a show in Melbourne last weekend, and then a show in Brisbane, and I had three seminars that I did, you know, and some other little odds and ends. So it's good. All in all, a good trip. Awesome. You know, get to mix business and pleasure a little bit, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah,
yeah, the tender time, you know?
Oh boy.
What's wrong? Come on.
Hey, gotta get it.
I deal with this every Tuesday, so it's no different.
It's back to the future. If it's okay to call you Ken. Ken, you are, it's Friday, 11 a.m. And we're talking.
It's tomorrow morning. 11 a.m.
Yes, tomorrow morning. It went on to you from yesterday at 7:12 p.m. Eastern time. So
and the beautiful thing is when I come, you know, it takes about 30 some hours to get here from the States. And going back, it takes just as long, but it only technically takes like 12 hours because I'm back in time. So, you know, I gain a bunch of time going back. It's great.
Perfect.
So I leave Friday morning and I get home Friday night to the States, which normally would be, you know, I'd leave the States on like say Friday and I wouldn't get here till Saturday or Sunday because of all the travel. And it is a brutal, brutal travel too. It's, you know, I live in Minneapolis, so it's 5 hours to LA and then LA to Melbourne is 17 hours, I believe.
Ooh,
17 hours. Sitting on a plane with crying babies and, you know,
yeah.
People's bodily functions.
Bodily fluids. Well, speaking of traveling, to start things off, you said traveling to Australia can be brutal. Talk about the travel, if you can, of being a professional wrestler or they call sports entertainer. Any brutal stories you can give us about traveling, whether it be WWE, Independence, or TNA?
Well, I remember, well, the thing is I don't remember a lot of what happened when I was in the WWE because it's you're traveling 5 to 7 days a week, and it's, we don't have, you know, normal people work 10, 12-hour days at most. You know, if you work a 12-er, it's, I had to pull a 12-er. We work sometimes, you know, 18, 19-hour days with, you know, when you figure in gym time and drive time to the building, you got to get to the building early, you got to spend a few hours at the building, then you wrestle, then you get in the car and drive to the next town, which is sometimes 4 or 5 hours away. Yeah. And you do that 5 days a week. And when you do international travel, it's 7 days a week because you don't get time off. And I remember my first international tour that I did with WWE, we did 19 shows in 19 different cities and countries in 21 days.
Wow.
And I can't remember anything about it. People will oftentimes remind me of things like, hey, you did this or you did that, or, you know, I'll travel somewhere like Rome and I'll be like, oh, I was here a bunch of times. You know, I was in Rome 6 times before I ever got to actually see anything in Rome. We just Wow. Which is another thing. Jeez. People think, oh, you travel all to all these great places in the world. It must be exciting. And it is. Don't get me wrong. I'm not complaining about it. But you're just seeing the inside of a bus, the inside of a plane, the inside of a hotel, and the inside of an arena. And really, you don't get to actually go out and experience the cultures and stuff.
Oh, lockdown.
Yeah, when you were in the States traveling with the WWE, who was your favorite person to travel with, if you did travel with anybody?
I traveled a lot with, you know, when I started there, I was driving with Paul Burchill and Daivari. Daivari and I had come up on in the business together in Minneapolis. Really good friends. I remember Batista pulled me aside one day. It was relatively early on. I had only been on the road for a few months. And he said, hey, nothing against those guys, but what are you going to learn from riding with those guys? You need to get in the car with a veteran. And so I remember I asked Chris Benoit if I could ride with him. And then he said, well, I'm riding with Eddie, so you have to ask him. And he checked it all out. It checked out. It was fine. So I rode with them for a while, which was an interesting experience. I drove the entire, and that was one of the things he said. He goes, just so you know, you're driving like every minute of the tour. And I expected to, you know, that's part of paying your dues and showing respect to the people that came before you. And so I rode with them for a few weeks up until Eddie passed away. And then Chris decided that he sort of wanted to be with, you know, Rey Mysterio and some of those guys in Chavo who were closer with Eddie so that they could sort of mourn together, be together, have each other's back. And so then I started riding with Matt Hardy and Shane Helms. And we fantastic times. You know, I remember one time we were in a car. We had a rental car that for some reason didn't have AC, didn't have an air conditioner. It was super hot, and we were somewhere down south. And I remember just to make us laugh, at some point, Matt and I were sitting, and Matt was driving, and I was sitting in the passenger seat, and we heard like, oh God, help me. And we kind of turn around, or Matt looks in the rearview mirror, and Shane was down to his boxer shorts, just covered in sweat, just like,
oh, wow.
Oh, man.
Really funny stuff.
Shout out.
What was that?
No, I was saying shout out to Shane Helms, a good buddy of ours, who's very busy in social media.
Very, very good friend of mine. Good guy.
That's awesome.
Very witty. He's like probably the wittiest and funniest person that I know. We've been doing these tours of the Middle East for Armed Forces Entertainment. We've done two so far. We're working on putting together a third one where we go over and we entertain the troops in the Middle East at different bases. And he's been on both tours, and you know, my stomach at the end of the tour hurts. My stomach hurts. My throat hurts from laughing so hard. He's such a funny guy.
Yeah, well, that's awesome. I don't mention personal stuff often, but me and Shane are friends on Facebook. And if you remember, there was a jobber named the Milkman. He was just on SmackDown. He went against Kane. So I put up a status where I said, worst, you know, annoying singer, annoying group. So the Milkman put 3 count. So. So Shane Helms said sacrilege, laugh out loud. So
he likes to be reminded of that. But
yes, he does. He does. Since we're talking about Matt Hardy, a fan question to you. Are you privy to the final deletion the TNA did with Broken Matt, Brother Nero, and of course with the Lake of Reincarnation? A lot of people want to know, Ken, your thoughts of it. Did you enjoy it? Some of the older, you know, the older wrestlers, you know, the seniors of the world didn't like it. What did you think of it?
I love it. It's entertainment. It's different. It's thinking outside the box. You know, it's not pretending to be something that it's not. I think a lot of times wrestling insults people's intelligence sometimes it's okay to give a little wink to the audience and let them know, like, we know that you know, And it is what it is. It's intentionally, you know, it's not trying to have a, they're not trying to have good TV. It's bad movie night. You know, that's what it is. And it's intended to be that way. And I think they do a really good job at it. And, you know, that final deletion where it was almost, you know, supernatural. There was all sorts of supernatural things happening. Like he drowned Jeff in the water. And then he went over and looked at the body. And it was actually the caretaker or whatever.
Caretaker, right.
You know, that kind of stuff. Just, you never see that in wrestling. And I enjoy it for what it is. At first, I was a little skeptical just because I think wrestling is already guilty of bad acting a lot. Like, there's some pretty bad acting that goes on in wrestling pretty regularly.
Yeah. Yes.
And so I was like, we're already bad enough the way that it is. Like, why do you want to make it worse? But it just works for me. So. Okay,
Speaking of acting, Ken, what are your, and we don't have to ask you to be honest, because we're honest. I know you're very honest. What are your thoughts of the WWE films? A lot of people hate them. It's like, oh, here we go. It's like 85 Marines and 39 Condemns. Sure. What are your thoughts of WWE films?
They cost about $5 to $10 million to make, and they end up making around $100 million because of DVD sales. And so even if they made, you know, if they cost $5 million to make and it made $1 million, to me, it's worth it. So, you know, they're not fantastic. I wish the WWE would actually invest some money in a really good script and, you know, use the WWE talent, but flank that talent by really good Hollywood actors. Mm-hmm. You know, I always felt like, and it's almost too late now because every cartoon or every comic book movie has been done, but I always thought, like, it would be great for WWE to buy into a franchise and showcase their talent alongside good actors. Like what happened with Batista and Guardians of the Galaxy. But that's separate because Batista didn't have anything to do with the WWE at that time. That was all on his own. So that's, I wish they would actually just spend some time and get some good scripts. Because I think there's a lot of potential there. I think there's a lot of better actors at the WWE than they get credit for.
Okay, thank you for that. Go ahead, Saltine.
All right, here's a question about your travels. During your travels, what were some places you loved to be? I mean, like, were there food restaurants, like, different areas where you were? Like, can you tell us some travel places you love?
So, this is a great question because people ask me, you know, what's your favorite place in the world to travel to? And hands down, unequivocally, the U.S., the United States of America.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Is the best place to travel. We've got it so good, we don't realize how good we have it. The roads, the food, you know, you can pretty much get anything that you want. Any type of, you know, any, you know, Chinese food, to Italian food and everything in between.
Right.
In the United States, you get these blends of, you know, Chinese and Southern cooking,
right.
You know, really cool stuff. So our internet is fantastic. Usually I can be driving down the road and I've got internet coverage. You know, I go to England and I don't have that. I have to wait until I'm at a hotel, and generally the hotel doesn't have good internet coverage. So then it's, when I do have it, it's choppy at best. But with that being said, my favorite country to travel to outside of the U.S. are Japan. Like, Tokyo is probably one of my favorite places I've ever been to in my life.
Yes.
And here in Australia. And it's just, you know, the people are so kind. Especially when you go to Japan, I remember, you know, I've been in situations in the States where, remember a couple years ago, I was at a GameStop for WrestleMania. It was WrestleMania weekend. And this lady came up to me and she goes, "You're not going anywhere." And she turned around and walked away. And she's like, I'm like, "Oh, did this just happen? Seriously?" And she brings her you know, she goes and grabs her 5-year-old kid and leads him by the hand over. And I'm thinking, I got to say something to her. I have to dress her down for this. Like, that's so rude. But then I thought, I'm not going to punish the 5-year-old kid because mom's an asshole. Sorry, can I say that?
Sure.
Oh, yeah. You
sure? You sure?
Okay.
Fine.
We're not so, you know, I'm not going to punish the kid because mom doesn't have any cooth. So, you know, but you get a lot of that in the U.S. where people just expect you to bend over backwards for them. And I generally try to because, look, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing without the fans and stuff. But in Japan, I remember, like, I was there with my ex-wife, and it was 6 a.m., and we went down to the lobby to meet whoever was taking us around to do some media. And there was probably 50 people standing in the lobby who had waited there all night long. And they don't just come up to you and stick a piece of paper in your face or, you know, just stand next to you and somebody snaps a picture. They ask very politely. They were, I remember they had gifts for both of us. You know, this is for you. This is for her. Will you please take a picture with me? You know, so it was kind of an exchange thing. And it was really, really cool. I got like a giant bin full of stuff just from gifts that I got from Japan. And it's nothing, you know, crazy, like little fans and little things like that. But to me, it's the thought that counts, right?
Okay, so while we're on talking about the fans and everything, what do you think about the, well, you know, it was all over the internet with Randy Orton cussing out a person that when he was in the gym with, and then he just he was in the gym, and apparently a fan came up to him and asked him if he could get an autograph or a picture with him. And Randy, apparently, I think, cussed him out and told him no. But then he came back on the internet and was like, well, I don't see why everybody's mad with me. If you could have waited until after I finished my workout, I wouldn't have a problem with, you know, coming and taking a picture with you and giving you my autograph. But everybody was weighing in on it.
Yeah, so that doesn't surprise me. Because he's known for being that way. But the thing is like, what happened to him in that situation could have been exactly what happened to me at that GameStop. You know what I'm saying? Right. Like, that person could have come up to him and just said, you're giving me an autograph and a picture. At which point, I chose to take the high road because the little kid was there, but had that little kid not been there, I would have probably cussed her out too. You know, so it's possible that that situation occurred and you just don't hear about, you just hear Randy Orton cuss the lady out. You don't hear that the guy or whatever, the guy or the lady was a total jerk. And then the other thing is, so I can't imagine, I always say, like, I can't imagine what it must be like to be a Tom Cruise or like a true celebrity, like one of those A-listers. That you can't go put gas in your car without somebody, hey, can I see you? And yes, you should be open and accessible to your fans, but when you can't do anything, you can't turn around, you can't leave your house without somebody sticking a camera in your face or something, like you can't actually get anything done. You know what I mean? It would just take you all day. If you went to the gas station and you had to, every time you went to the gas station just to put gas in your car, it took you an extra hour and a half because you had to sign autographs and pictures for everybody. I sort of get it. I sort of understand it because I've experienced that on a way lower level. But, you know, depending on where I go in the country and, you know, what the scenario is, if there's, you know, if going to a town where there's a pay-per-view in town and everybody's kind of there, it's that's the sort of thing. You go to the gas station, you run into fans. You go to the hotel lobby, you run into fans. You go out to eat, you run into fans. Whereas now I live in Minneapolis, I can just go to the Mall of America and, you know, nothing's going on there right now. So I walk around and nobody says anything.
Right.
Yeah, the memories of Mall of America. Woo! Those times.
Yeah. Right. I understand what the fans wanting to come and, you know, ask you questions, get autographs, get pictures, because I'm still a fan, even though I'm working in media. I can get with and back at the indie shows, and you know, I'm still working, but yeah, I'm like, oh my god, this such and such person here, this such and such person there. It was one time I was at an indie show, and I was actually in the show because it was like a spur of the moment thing. One of the wrestlers asked me to walk out with them, and I was standing in the back, but next to a fan, and I'm just standing because I was waiting for the wrestler to come back out. And I'm standing there, and I'm like, okay, I'm waiting. And then I turn around and look, and J.J. Dillon was standing next to me. I was like, I'm like, oh, my God. Mr. Dillon is standing next to me. You know, I got all excited on the inside, but on the outside, I didn't show it. So I was like, because he was sitting there with his son, and I was like, well, I just turned and said, Mr. Dillon, is it okay if I get a picture with you? He said, sure. You know, if you do it like that, you go up to them and just ask them nicely, and if they're into a conversation, wait. If they're doing something else, come back. You know, that's I see that as, you know, giving them their space, and you know, just giving them that, just ask them nicely. I'm sure they'll do it for you. Just don't like stick a pen in their paper in their face and like, can you give me the autograph? You know what I'm saying?
Or give me an autograph.
Yes.
Yeah. That's crazy.
I've been fortunate to work with and become friends with some of my favorite wrestlers of all time. You know, Austin, Undertaker. I still inside am like, that's really cool.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
We're all fans. Wrestlers are the biggest fans of all. I was such a fan that I decided to shave my legs and wear baby oil and tights for a living. You know, like, we're the biggest fans out there. We take it all the way where we actually want to do this. So I totally get it. You never stop being a fan. You shouldn't. But it's how you conduct yourself, you know, if you... We're professionals. And at the end of the day, they are just people. We're just people walking through life. We got the same problems... bills and, you know, relationship troubles and dog troubles and stuff like that everybody else goes
some through. Drug problems. Some people drug problems.
Yep. Yeah. Right. Yeah, exactly.
All right.
Now with you, Ken, why is it that you have a reputation of being a butthole, an asshole? I remember the TNA shirt you had to say asshole, which I love. Why is it that you've had a reputation over the years, and it's not from us, it's in general with wrestlers, and people say, oh, Kennedy's an asshole, he's a loud mouth. And a lot of times we realize the ones that, you know, the boys or the higher ups consider assholes or big mouths are just the ones that don't take any crap, that are vocal, that don't lay down. So do you consider yourself in that area where you just speak your mind and you're honest, so you get labeled as an asshole?
No, I'm actually... I think I'm a really good, nice person. I generally try to be nice to everybody. I treat other people the way that I want to be treated. It used to drive me crazy when we would go to buildings and people, like some of the wrestlers wouldn't even talk to the janitor or the people doing the lighting or the sound or whatever. They didn't even know what their names were. Those were the people that I always gravitated to. To talk to those people, just because you could just have normal conversations. But I think, you know, part of it is that's the character that I play on TV. I play an asshole. I remember a long time ago, I was 19, 20, 21 years old, right around that time. And people would take advantage of me because I was so nice to them. And I remember my ex-girlfriend at the time said, nice guys finish last. And so I sort of adopted that. And in my character that I play on TV or when I do a wrestling show, I do and say all the things that everybody's actually thinking. They want to say it, but I get to do it. And I get to say like, oh, that was just my character speaking. Sorry. but then, you know, I do try to be as honest as I can with how I'm feeling what my thoughts are. I might be completely wrong in my thinking, but at least I will be generally forthright. You ask me how I feel about a particular topic, I'm okay telling you. Because it's true, and I act that way towards everybody. You know, I don't ever... I always hated when, you know, people that I'd work with, this is any job, act a fool. And then when the boss comes around, like, oh, they're on their best behavior. If you just act like you normally do all the time, you know what I mean? Then you don't have to put on this show. And I felt like it was always a facade. So, yeah, I'm honest. And I'm honest to the point that, like, sometimes I've been dishonest with answers because I felt like it was nobody's business. You know, it was somebody else. Like, somebody would ask me a question, and I wouldn't necessarily lie to them, but I wouldn't give them the whole answer because, like, you shouldn't be asking me that question in the beginning.
Oh, damn. Like, you a know? True lie.
Yeah. Like, I had a family member one time who asked me if I'd ever used steroids. No, of course not. And then later on, it was found out that I did. You know, it came out in the media because I admitted it and said that I did. And he was so butthurt, so pissed off at me. I asked you, and you lied to me. Well, you shouldn't ask the fucking question to begin with.
None of your business. Exactly.
And if I would have said none of your business, it's an admission of guilt, basically, right? I mean, even though that should be the answer, like, that's not something I'm willing to talk to you about, even if you did or didn't do it. So I think people in the world, we like to pretend and give service to the media. We like it when people are honest. We want people to just shut up and agree, you know, politically or otherwise. You're just supposed to shut your mouth.
Right.
And the thing is like, I have political disagreements all the time. I have religious disagreements all the time with people. But let's talk about it. Let's actually have a discussion about it. And I may view something completely wrong, and you can change my mind. And I'm open to the idea that I'm wrong. I could be wrong about everything.
Right.
Instead of fighting about differences, talk about it. Sometimes you got to agree to disagree. Okay, you swing right, or you swing left, or you swing in the middle. Now, I know on my show we joke, we say shout out to Ralph Nader, the independent. You know, it seems like he has no fan base, but you know, like regardless, he, you know, give him credit. Is, you know, if you Republican, Democrat, independent, whatever, this is how I feel. This is how I feel. I agree to disagree. We all have friends in the business. We all know wrestlers we see on TV, including yourself and agents that pro-Trump, against Trump, people, black people that hated Obama but never said it publicly. Mm-hmm. That's how you feel. That's fine. So,
and that's okay. We can have those differences. We can have those disagreements. And, you know, I just think that people have to sometimes be able to be willing to challenge their own beliefs, no matter what it is. Yeah. I cannot, it boggles my mind that with all that we know about how the political systems work in just about every country, including our own, that, you know, it's, if I'm a Democrat, then the Democrats are always right. And if I'm a Republican, then the Republicans are always right. And if you look, you can see that, like, these guys have some good ideas over here. These guys have some really fucking terrible ideas, too. And the same thing goes for the other side, and the same thing goes for the middle. Why can't we just all pull from, and that's the way it's supposed to be, right? That's the fairy tale. So, I think it does.
How do you feel, Ken, that as a fan texted me yesterday, how do you feel about the fact that some people don't even say our president? The president of the United States, Donald Trump, is a former WWE Hall of Famer.
that stuff doesn't bother me. You know, can he get the job done or can he not? That's what it ultimately boils down. I don't care if you, you know, look, Obama got a lot of heat for going on Saturday Night Live and late night talk shows and stuff like that, and reaching out and touching a new fan base, you know, than just old people. They all seem like the only people that ever paid attention to politics. And, you know, he reached out to that new fan base. He got a lot of heat for that. Why is he doing that when he should be just doing his job? I feel like I was with Bobby Lashley this weekend here in Australia. And Kenny King had posted something a while ago. It was a meme of Bobby Lashley getting his hand raised in the air by Donald Trump at WrestleMania 23.
Oh, man.
And he was like, Bobby Lashley is to blame. He could have ended this for us a long time ago.
Oh, man.
You know,
oh, my goodness.
Shout out to Bobby Lashley. I know we joked about Lashley with the I know I tweeted and tagged him in the Harlem Globetrotter, the headband he wears when he wrestles. Definitely a big guy, man.
What's the deal with the headband? I didn't know that there was a
lot of people joke. The Harlem Globetrotters, you know, the basketball team, black basketball team, they always wore the headbands like Lashley wear now. So a lot of people joke, like, Lashley wearing the Harlem Globetrotter headband.
I'm not so sure that there's a connection there, but.
Yeah, that's. Some of them have worn it before, like the ABA, like the little round headbands. But we've had
Has Bobby said in an interview
that's why he does it? No. Oh, okay. No, it's just a joke. Yeah, this is fantasy. Unless you got the Harlem Globetrotter headband on the ABA. So, but
we have a couple of fan questions for you. The first one is a fan wanted to know what made you become a wrestler, and then the second question is who was your favorite match against and why?
So, I wanted to be a wrestler. I didn't watch wrestling as a kid growing up. I wasn't a fan, but I was always into acting. I remember E.T. was the first movie that I saw in the theater with my mother. And I turned to her and I said, like, how do I do that? And she was like, oh, it's impossible. You can't do it. You have to know the right people. You have to live in Hollywood. And you have to. And, you know, okay. So I just kind of forgot that. But my whole life I was doing plays and, you know, putting together. I remember we'd get sometimes somebody would have like one of those big VHS video cameras. And it was the greatest thing in the world because we could do our own movies. And, you know, we did like little horror movies and edited together, showed them to our friends and family and stuff. So I always wanted to get into acting.
Oh, cool.
And then I always played sports and was into sports and stuff. And it wasn't until I was like 21 years old when I was at a buddy's house. And he sort of said, we're watching wrestling tonight. I'm like, we're not watching a bunch of guys rolling around on the floor with each other wearing tights. Not happening.
Right.
And then I remember as we were talking, you know, I heard this glass break and I saw a guy drive to the ring in a big black pickup truck and he had a 6-pack of beer on his lap. I get the hell out of my way to the camera guy. He opened that door and the way he swaggered into the ring and I was like, this guy's awesome.
Yes.
And so I started watching every week just to see what he would do. And then I was like, well, you know, the Undertaker's pretty cool. And the Rock's starting to grow on me. And, you know, you get sucked into everything else. And then I realized, like, wow, I've been missing out on this. This is great entertainment. And it's such a great mix of all the things that I love.
Right.
Athleticism and acting, let's put them together. And that's sort of why I wanted to do this business. And as far as my favorite opponent goes, that's really, really tough question to ask.
Okay.
It's kind of like asking you, like, what's your favorite song or what's your favorite movie? You know, it's like, you got 20 different favorite movies and 20 different favorite songs. Depends on what mood you're in, right? But I will say that One of my favorite matches that I've ever had was Kurt Angle inside the steel cage at Lockdown.
Yeah.
It was 09 or 2010 or something like that.
Yeah, 09. Yeah,
right. Was.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've had some great stuff with Bubba, Bully Ray Douglas. What was I going to say?
Bully Ray Douglas.
Bully.
you know, Bubba and Jeff Hardy. I had a cool experience with Sting where I got to dress up like Sting, like the old Sting.
Mm. Right.
Which was really cool because that fan in me, right? I'm still a fan.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Sting actually painted my face.
Oh,
he was actually a guy. I was going out there to mock him and do it. And he painted my face because who would know better how to do that makeup than the man himself. And he actually let me use his outfits too.
Right.
Right.
I think we lost Tex.
See, Evan didn't want to be with us anymore.
Oh, crap. Let's see.
I think we lost him.
All right. Let me ask you a fan question there that we got to keep going. During your time with WWE, there were rumors about you playing the illegitimate son of Vince McMahon. Can you tell the fans the story about it, if true? Also, the environment in WWE, how was it when you were there?
Yeah, that was true. That was going to happen. And then I got in trouble.
Oh, boy.
So that didn't end up happening.
Yes.
But, you know, as far as the environment goes, everybody always talks about how, you know, and people do walk around on eggshells sometimes, but I think it's their own doing.
Mm-hmm.
They don't need to walk around on eggshells. Just go there, be a good person, work hard.
Yeah.
Do your job.
Mm-hmm. Of course, I agree.
It's like any other job, you know, but people are constantly worried. You know, the thing is that almost everybody that gets hired by the WWE gets fired by the WWE.
Agree.
With the exception of, like, Undertaker, John Cena.
Agree.
I'm bad, guys.
Vince McMahon.
Yep.
Triple H. You know, there's all the history of the business that just don't get fired. They're just there forever.
Yeah.
So it's going to happen to everybody eventually.
He's
and everybody's sort of wondering when is that going to happen to me?
Oh, true.
Right. I know it's coming. Because you go from making really good money, being in the spotlight, being on TV every week, to what do I do after? Do I have to go back to being a normal person? And and you don't. There's life after WWE. Living proof.
True. But and like I heard stories about Undertaker. Like Undertaker was a locker room leader. He was really cool, and really, he was a sweetheart. Any Undertaker stories you have?
He really is, like, you know, they say that he's a locker room leader, and it wasn't like he demands respect, he commands respect.
Oh, yeah.
People respect him because they want to respect him, not because he's been in the business for 30 years and I have to respect him.
Right.
It's just that's the way he is. When you have a problem, you go to Taker, and you ask him. I just remember, you know, one of my favorite when it was a birthday story. It was me, Matt Hardy, and Undertaker went out for my birthday.
Okay.
Just the three of us after a SmackDown taping, and we ended up at this bar, and Taker would just, you know, let me see your Jack Daniels. He'd say to the bartender, so let me see your Jack Daniels. The guy pull up the bottle. It'd be like a 3/4 full, and he'd just go, yeah, that'll be good. Just thumb those out into shot glasses and bring them over here.
Hmm.
And, we...
Did you partake in the Jack Daniels can?
Yes, I did. And I remember waking up the next morning, and I was sharing a hotel room with Matt Hardy, and I remember waking up, and my flight was supposed to be at 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning, and I woke up and, I mean, the sun is just beaming through the curtains, through the little crack in the curtain, whatever. Like, and Matt sat up and he goes, Ken, it's okay, it's okay. I called the office, booked you on another flight. You got like 2 hours. You can keep sleeping. Like, you missed your flight. Your girlfriend at that time has been calling all night long. And she was worried that I was out gallivanting around getting in trouble. And, you know, he actually answered my phone after like the 20th phone call. He answered my phone and he was like, he's fine. He's passed out. We had a lot to drink tonight with Taker, and he's good. And no. Where is he? You're covering for him. And he apparently at some point stuck the phone up to my face and just like slapped me. And I went, you know.
Were you witness to?
What's that?
No, go ahead. Continue.
No, he was able to convince her eventually something like that. Like, I was actually sleeping in bed and, you know, not out at a strip club or something like that. So that was, yeah, that was one of my fondest memories. Boys look out for each other.
Have you witnessed Undertaker get drunk?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he doesn't change much, though. Like, if anything, he's happy and, you know, he's not like, you know, some people when they drink, they change. They turn either really nasty or just stupid drunks or
dancing naked.
Like, he's just a happy drunk.
What? No. Okay. Where did the dancing naked part come from?
I'm killing his whole gimmick here. Like, he's going to be pissed at me because I'm just destroying his reputation.
You'll never destroy his reputation with me because I am, and I will admit it, I'm a huge Undertaker fan. I've been a fan of his since he stepped foot into the WWE, right along with Stone Cold Steve Austin. So you would never, ever ruin their reputation for me.
The only thing that absolutely sucks about The Undertaker is that he's a freaking Cowboys fan.
Nope, you're still not going to get me. I still love him. Well, I refuse to back down. I still love him.
I'm sorry. Is that the missus?
I believe so. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are we in trouble? Hopefully we're not in trouble.
No, we're good. We're good. No, okay. I was in trouble. No, she gave me a look.
So speaking of Cowboys fans, one of my other favorites, that's going to lead to a question. I was looking at my screen, a fan sent. Sting. Sting is a Cowboys fan too. Sorry to hear it. Sting's been always one of my favorites as well as Undertaker. Talk about the time you dressed up. A fan that sent me this. I'm looking at my screen. You dressing up as Sting in TNA, which I thought was great. Look, you look just like him. the jacket.
We've already gone over this, but you decided to
Yeah, you did. You missed it. Yeah, you missed it.
No, but I'll tell you real quick in a nutshell. It was my idea to do it, and he was all completely on board to do it, and he ended up, as I said before, he allowed me to use his wardrobe. So those were the costumes that I was wearing were actually Sting's old costumes.
Oh, wow.
And then he did my face paint.
Oh, wow.
You know, he knew exactly how to do it. But really cool experience.
Well, I know you probably didn't cover this, the Rumble. But my phone randomly went black. When we started talking politics, my phone shut off. I don't know if it was the Illuminati or what was going on with that. The Royal Rumble is coming up. And I know that a lot of people we talk to that used to be in WWE or we have friends in TNA, not really much of a fan of the product of wrestling, especially WWE. Can you tell us any Rumble stories, your first Royal Rumble, and if you were a fan of the actual match?
It's my favorite match of the entire year for all of wrestling. No. I love it. It's just, you never know what to expect. There's always some really cool surprises, some people debuting, some old stars that come back, and you get to see them for a few minutes, and it's just a feel-good match, right? And I always wanted to, even when I was there at the WWE, I never wanted to know what the finish was going to be. So I would just stay as far away from that as I could. I wouldn't get any info. The year that I was in the Royal Rumble, and I ended up I came down to number 5 or 6, I believe. I was in there relatively late. And I remember that, I was one of the last 5 or 6 guys left in the ring. And I believe it was Shawn Michaels that eliminated me in the end. But the cool thing is they would do, when they're planning it out, they'd do 5 people. And when they get to the 5th elimination, they would say, all right, you guys, get up, leave the room. You don't need to know anymore. And then, the next 5 people, all right, when you guys...
Right.
Yeah. So they go through like not the hit rumble, don't have to know what's gonna happen. So it was pretty cool. And I was in late enough where I believe John Cena came back, and it was John Cena's surprise return. He had been gone with an injury. Mm-hmm. And so we're all in the room, and then like, you know, these people leave, and then John Cena walks in, sits down, and continues the conversation. So even the boys that were there earlier didn't know. So it was pretty cool.
Right. Like me with the Royal Rumble, I loved it when they first started out, when you didn't know who was going to come out, what surprises were going to happen, and anything. Now it's like you're going to know who every person is going to be in the Rumble now. So how do you feel about that now?
Yeah, I hate that. Like I said, that's my favorite part about the Rumble, like you just said. Right. You know, Tatanka, I haven't seen Tatanka in forever. Like,
right.
It was Mr. Perfect. Haku one year. I remember, you know, stuff like that. Gilbert's coming back, you know.
Yes.
Right, they did. They mentioned like 20. We had like the last we heard was like 22 guys mentioned that they were going to be in the Royal Rumble. So we have like what seven guys left that we don't know who's going to be in. Yeah, so we don't know who the seven guys are left.
I don't know anything. I don't know anything about that. So.
I mean, hey. I'm like, I love element of surprise. That Royal Rumble is always.
Mr. Anderson can make an appearance. We never know. You can make an appearance in the Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You never know.
Ken, you have a Mickey Mouse shirt on. Shout out to Mickey Mouse. Favorite Disney movie? Or first couple that comes to mind?
You know what? This is going to sound like my man card is totally revoked after this, but... Because I watch it with my little sister when I was a kid, like The Little Mermaid, I remember she used to watch that thing like every single morning. So I knew all the songs, you know, everything. And I actually remember looking at it from like an artistic standpoint. And I was just like, just amazes me like how good the animation was. And I think that was before they were using computers to animate everything.
It was.
You know, right. It was done by hand. Yep. Cell by cell. It was just so cool when somebody would speak, their lips would actually move, you know,
right?
Yeah.
Like your mouth would normally move when you said that word. It was really, really cool. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, that's the one that sticks out in my head. Disney World is my favorite place to go on planet Earth. And I've got twin 3-year-olds and they love Mickey. They love anything to do with, like, the Mickey Mouse Clubhouse is their favorite show on TV. And, right. You know, anytime. I was wearing a different Mickey Mouse shirt a few days ago, and I FaceTimed with my kids back in the States. And my son was wearing a Mickey Mouse shirt. And it was like, Daddy, Mickey. Like, you know, he recognized that I was wearing Mickey, and he was wearing Mickey, too. It was kind of a cool little moment.
Awesome.
I can't wait till they're too young to actually... They're too young to actually take them. You hear that noise?
Yes.
Yes.
That was the guard dog here. Who was about that big.
Whoa.
What did he say, that big?
Whoa. Let's go get him.
Aww. Get him.
Say hi. Oh, thank you.
Aww. Thank you. Kisses. I have one that's small, too. I have a Morky, which is a Yorkie and a Maltese mix. Her name is Bella.
Okay.
But she's so bad. She's a sweet girl, but she is so bad and barks at everything.
That's my girlfriend's dog. And
mm-hmm.
All night long. Like she said, there's cats that roam through like the backyard or whatever, and mm-hmm. you just scream at them.
Wow. But
dogs are great. They're just.
Mm-hmm. I like.
I had a dog. I had a wire haired fox terrier. For it was like a 25-pound dog, kind of a medium sized dog, and just the personality that mm-hmm. that your dog has, right? It's just amazing. You don't realize it until you actually have a dog. So.
Yep.
Well, in tribute to you, Ken, Saltine has a dog. We call it a Salty Mutt. He's a pit bull named Max. So Saltine, yeah, I don't know if Max is gonna come on screen. Salty, is that right?
Nah, he's asleep. He's resting.
Awesome.
I'll tell you what, like, pit bulls get such a bad name, but they're amazing dogs. Ooh. And it definitely comes down to the owner and the training that you put the dog through.
Ken, you being a Green Bay fan, I know Green Bay got torched by the Falcons, wasn't a fan of it. Who's your favorite? Yes. And we're from Baltimore, so we're Ravens fans. Not sure if you like the Baltimore Ravens at all. But
I'm just a football fan in general, so.
Yeah, I'm like you. Yeah, I love the Ravens, but I'm
especially a Packers fan, but.
Yes.
Who do you prefer? You have Aaron Rodgers now, of course, Brett Favre, and then before Bart Starr. Who would you become more of a fan of?
Brett Favre's my absolute favorite. Like, just the way that he played the game, he always looked like even when they were losing, he still looked like he was out there having fun.
Right.
You know, Aaron Rodgers, obviously I love him. You know, he's my quarterback. He's great at his job, but he gets so down. I always hate, Jay Cutler
was
always a quarterback that when he's not doing well, you know it, and everybody else knows it because he goes and he sulks on and nobody can talk to him. And I always hated that attitude, and I sort of feel like Rodgers has that too, where if he throws a pass and the guy's not right there running the perfect route, he's, come on, man, you know. There are mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, every quarterback would have 100% completion. But
it could be the reverse with all quarterback Flacco, where he's like a machine, where it's no emotion. You win, you lose.
He gets a boo boo face when things don't go his way.
Yeah,
like, right.
He does. Actually, a few more questions, Ken. I got some. Okay, chewing gum. And I know you're a big fan of chewing gum. Might be Mr. Perfect. What was your favorite brand of gum?
It's
a source told me that. And we got a little hint, inside news that Triple H or somebody didn't like the fact you was chewing gum in WWE, or some people didn't like the fact you had gum in your mouth. So is that true?
Yeah, he was always chewing.
It was Vince. Vince hated it.
It was Vince.
And the answer is that I think it's dentine or trident. I don't know. It's fire. It's like the cinnamon flavored.
Yeah.
Gum. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Fun fact that when cinnamon is one of the only smells that'll mask any other smell. So if you are worried that you might have garlic breath, you chew some cinnamon gum. Like, if you chew wintergreen gum and you do have garlic breath, that garlic will. It's like somebody who doesn't take a shower and has bad BO and just puts urine on underneath.
Right.
Like, you can still smell it. Oh, is it worse?
Right, yeah. Right, right.
So I like the cinnamon gum. Mm. I like that hard gum. Do you
like Big Red? Because I'm a Big Red girl. Big Red gum.
I like Big Red. Yeah. Awesome. But I like that fire stuff because it's got that hard shell on the side and something really satisfying about that. I started chewing gum in the ring because I get really bad cotton mouth when I wrestle. My mouth just dries up, and I talk a lot of trash when I'm out there wrestling. So I'm not, that good. I'm very vocal and not good to have cotton mouth. And I remember as a kid, my grandma used to get so upset when she would see somebody chomping on their gum. You know, look at him, he's disrespectful. And I heard other people throughout the years do that too. So I'm a bad guy. I'm very vocal. Why not? You know, it's just a little subtle something to irritate people even a little more. And Vince was so upset. Why are you always chewing your fucking gum? Stop it. Knock it off. And he would yell at me every time. And I remember thinking, and I should have said this to him, I'm trying. My job is to go out there and irritate people. Like, you're Vince McMahon. You've seen everything in this ring. And it's irritating you. What do you think it's
your job?
Right.
You know, generally speaking, if you're trying to pop the fans, pop the boys.
Wow.
If you can get the boys to pop for something, you're going to probably be able to get the fans. Because we're cynical. We've seen everything.
Oh my goodness, you got me all the time. You got me all the time when you got me all the time when you came out and was like, "I'm Mr. Kennedy, Mr. Kennedy." I was like, "Oh my god, this."
Can we say Kennedy on here? We okay?
Sure.
Can we say Anderson?
Anderson Kennedy.
It was like,
I don't think the WWE lawyers are coming beating our doors down to try to, you know.
Now, do you yell that name at your girlfriend just to be a prick? Just yell, I did that to my girl. Like,
oh my god, I think Mel will go off on you too.
Oh really?
She does it to me. So. No.
Now you debuted in TNA at Genesis, and I thought the promo you did was I just loved it. You mentioned social media. How was it? Talk about the difference of debuting in TNA or Impact as opposed to when you debuted in WWE. How did you feel?
Way different. I mean, as much as I won't say anything disparaging about.
Oh sure.
Another company. But at the end of the day, we all know, like, the WWE is the, you know, that's where everybody wants to be. They're the top dog by far. Right. Not to say that somebody else can't come along and remove them from that position. And I would love that if that would happen. But, you know, it's a different feeling. But at the same time, it was sort of a new beginning for me. I was sort of frustrated where I was at in WWE and the way that I was used. And I felt like, you know, I wasn't able to say what I wanted to say. I had this follow a script all the time and follow it perfectly or I'd get in trouble. And when I got to TNA, it was, here are some bullet points. As long as you hit these points, here's where we need to get to. Everything else, just put it in your own words. Say it like Ken Anderson would say it. So that was really cool. And that's, I was sort of given the freedom to do that. And that never went away at TNA. They never came up and said, because I was actually given that freedom when I first started in the WWE. And then, you know, a couple of people thought that I was probably too funny, too comical. You know, they obviously don't want you to go down the Keystone Cops, you know, totally silly Naked Gun route, because that just doesn't make
love Naked Gun
big money. I do too, but
love Naked Gun.
You know, it's not Steve Austin. Like, that character is never going to get over like Steve Austin got over or The Rock got over. Even though The Rock was funny all the time, one of the things that Vince told me one time was like, "Don't be funny. I'll stop making funny promos because they're going to always expect you to do that." He said Rock did that,
love it.
And Rock would go out there, and there was a period of time where I remember he would go out there and he would say almost the same stuff every week, and he would kind of shit the bed. Like, people, you always expect The Rock to be witty and funny and have something new and fresh to say. And when he doesn't, you're disappointed. So that was his point, and I completely agreed with it. Or maybe I didn't agree with it at the time, but I do now. After I got fired. She's not a
A fan question. I'm getting a fan question already. During TNA, you worked with Issy Carter, and I know a whole bunch of people were
very nice person.
Protest with this. What was it like working with Dixie Carter? Was she
I'm gonna just say what the fans say, a ditz,
or was she? Did she know what you were doing?
You know, she treats everybody the same way.
Really? Okay.
Speaking of bosses, you worked for Vince. And we heard Vince is very intense. Shout out to Coca-Cola, because that's the same thing I'm drinking as well. Local. I got the cup.
I am too. I just don't have my phone right now.
It's Australian Coca-Cola. So the can opens on the bottom side.
Oh, wow.
Oh, okay.
Try that.
He said he's kidding, y'all.
Yesterday we were driving, and there was a McDonald's sign. And there was a sign for, you didn't see this, there was a sign for, and it said the Australian Big Mac. And I'm like, what's the Australian Big Mac? And it was a picture of a Big Mac upside down.
Wow. Oh, wow. Okay.
Interesting. Speaking of the Big Mac, not sure if you know, Ken, here in the States, McDonald's just announced that they're giving away over 10,000 bottles of the Big Mac sauce.
See, I'm not the only one. I don't like it either.
High five.
Wow. See, I'm not the only one, Tech.
Not at all.
No, I'm not a Big Mac fan.
Wait, we got a few more minutes. A few more minutes, Ken. We don't want to hold you up too long. I know the missus is around you. Give you a few more minutes. Far as fast food restaurants, what are some of your favorites?
Taco Bell.
Yes.
Taco Bell. High five.
High five.
It's, hands down, it's Taco Bell. Arby's would probably be a close second. Right. The chili cheese burritos, I could just live off of chili cheese burritos at Taco Bell. Especially at 2 a.m. when you kind of got a gooner on and you get that drunk hungry. You know? You're drunkry.
No, but that's so.
I don't drink, so I wouldn't know. I don't drink at all.
Actually, Ken, it's a ritual for us when we do travel to, you know, go to shows and do media. The saltine starters, like, all right, we're gonna do Taco Bell with a Waffle House. Like, well, depending on where we're at, Taco Bell just goes to Waffle House.
See, the thing about Taco Bell,
we know those stories. Oh man,
you get the food now. Waffle House, you have to wait, and sometimes you don't get the best service. And, right. It depends if the waiter or waitress is having a bad day.
But
fair question. Taco Bell is like, it's Old Faithful.
Get it.
I can have food in my belly in the next 5 minutes. I'll go with that.
Right.
Big question. Okay, Mr. Anderson, all caps with like 1,000 exclamation points. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about WWE's catering and TNA's catering.
Oh, man.
Thank you, Philip.
TNA catering? Okay.
I don't know TNA has catering.
WWE has some damn good catering. Like, really, really good catering. And the TNA had catering.
Also, we know. Okay.
Hey, but
read between the lines.
The thing is, like, they didn't have to do it. They didn't have to have it at all. So the fact that they had anything for us was just fine. You know.
Right.
I don't need filet mignon with.
Everybody say that. Oh wow.
Pate on it, you know, for lunch. Just give me something. I'm good. That's what TNA really did. They. Some good food from now on. The only thing that I like, sort of frustrated me about that was, and everybody else, like, we're athletes. We have to run around in our underwear on TV. So you have to sort of eat to, like, 95% of the way that you look is how you, based on how you eat.
Right.
And, like, they would have chicken pot pies and, you know, stuff like that for us, Sloppy Joes. And,
right.
You got to eat something because you're so hungry.
Right. I'm not sure about the fellas, but I do. I watch Total Divas every Wednesday. So you will get to see the ladies.
My girlfriend's giving you the high five right now.
High five. where you get to see behind stage where they eat. So you get to see the ladies with the and the spread is like out of this world. I'm like, some of the stuff, I'm like, wow. And you can go back and see some of the ladies getting mashed potatoes and having hot dogs, and they just, it's like a real big, huge smorgasbord.
It really is. And I can't remember the lady's name, but they hired, when I was there, they hired a new lady to do the catering. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she'd have like three different soups, you know, really good soups like butternut squash and, you know,
right,
stuff like that, tomato bisque, crab bisque, New England clam chowder, and then she started having, there would be options for vegetarians and options for vegans, so that everybody kind of gets gets to eat a little something. It's really good food. She's fantastic.
Fan question again from Philip from New York. Does Vince McMahon, does he come down to eat with the boys?
Yes, he does. Yeah.
Oh.
Not often, but yeah, he just, he'll sit and sit right there, have a conversation with you, watch the monitor, talk about football, talk about, he is a normal guy at the end of the day. Yeah. Mm. Well, I can't remember him like having a team or anything like that, but he would at least attempt. See, Vince sort of does live inside a bubble where he doesn't know much about what goes on in the real world. Like, I bet you he knows nothing about Survivor or, you know, any of the top
television shows that are on
TV. What's up?
Heaven, Haven.
You watch football? Oh my goodness.
Yeah, that's the Tyler Perry show.
Yeah. Yeah. The 1%, right?
Now, did your girlfriend watch Heaven, Have Nuts?
Yeah.
No. Is that? No, that's an actual show?
Yeah.
Yes. It's a Tyler Perry show.
I thought you were referring to, like, Vince being a have and other
people. No. We know he's a have, but no, it's an actual show. Wow. It's one of many shows that Tyler Perry has on TV.
Well, yeah. I have. Is it a reality show or is it just a?
No, it's a scripted show. It's like a soap. Wow. Yeah.
We've been looking for a good new show.
He has like 5 million shows on TV right now.
Oh yeah, I know he's got a lot of movies.
He has a lot of TV shows too now. So how many tech? Like five or six?
Mm-hmm. We just watched a movie the other day. I think it was a Tyler Perry movie with Kevin Hart.
No.
Think Like a Man? Was that? Is that a?
No, Tyler that's Perry not movie? Tyler Perry.
That's not Tyler Perry.
That's not Tyler Perry.
It's a Kevin Hart movie, though.
That's a Kevin Hart movie, but it's not Tyler Perry.
Speaking of which, your favorite comedian? Are you a Kevin Hart fan?
I love Kevin Hart. I like. Bill Burr is one of my favorites now.
Yeah.
Dave Chappelle, like his Killing Them Softly, is one of my favorite bits of stand up ever. Oh, man. You guys know Bill Burr, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Big fan of his.
Just the way he's just, he's very blunt. And sometimes I get a kick out of listening to, he's got a podcast where he just talks about current events and stuff like that. And he's hilarious. You should give it a listen if you haven't.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. It's funny. Oh, yeah. Wow. Because we remember Patrice O'Neill, like, he died. He used to work for WWE.
I didn't really know much about Patrice O'Neill. I believe a writer for them. I just saw the roast.
Yeah, Patrice O'Neill. Yeah, like, I think he said he did some skits for, like, and, you know, some of the wrestlers and be hilarious.
And then, like, 2 weeks later, he died.
Hilarious. He was writing like, stuff. Come to find out, it's Patrice O'Neill. And I was like, wow.
Well, let you know, Ken, Dave Chappelle just signed the deal with Netflix. I think he's doing 2 or 3 events on Netflix coming up this year and into 2018.
I can't wait for that.
It is. Before we let you go, Ken, like you said, it's been an honor to have you on. Yeah. Nice guy, definitely. Contrary to what other people may say.
Asshole.
Yeah. So. are you a fan of the current products? And if not, what would you do to change it? Oh, you're a fan of the current product?
Hours. I'm saying, like, the 3-hour product drives me crazy. It's a full-time job to watch Monday Night Raw and to watch SmackDown and stuff. I feel like, and this is just my opinion, I feel like everything is so scripted. And when the matches are going on, they're not talking about the matches themselves, they're pimping whatever their other products are, and, you know, their different social media platforms. And remember they were starting up, they tried to start up some kind of a Twitter thing or a Facebook. Oh. They had their own little
tout.
Mm-hmm. You know, it was like Michael Cole was constantly pushing tout. That kind of stuff really drives me nuts.
You okay, Tech?
Yeah, I'm good.
What?
Oh, okay.
Why? What's wrong?
No, it looked like he was choking. I was just making sure he was okay.
Thought he was maybe, you know, like a big fan of tout, and, you know, I struck a nerve or something like that with him.
Oh, no. The way he bent over, I thought he was choking or something. I was just making sure he was okay. I'm like, we can't do anything from over here.
I'm good.
Shed a tear.
Is it? the microphone. What's next for Ken Anderson? Will we see you continue to wrestle maybe on a... We know you still do independence and seminars. You have your podcast. Yep, is there a chance we'll see you wrestle more on TV? Not necessarily WWE, but maybe appearances on Ring of Honor, TNA maybe, or are you going towards going in the direction of something else as far as like movies, TV, or other projects?
You know, it's possible. I won't ever rule anything out. But if somebody came to me tomorrow and said, you're done ever wrestling on TV, you know, you're done with wrestling, you're moving on to the next chapter of your life, I think I'd be content. I say that now until it actually happens. But I just opened up a wrestling school in Minneapolis with my best friend, Sean Davari.
Yes.
And we've got Arya Davari is, you know, one of our trainers, which he's obviously not there much right now because he's on the road full time with Monday Night Raw, 205 Live. But Molly Holly's also attached to our school, and Eric Cannon as well.
So
we just opened our doors in December. And we've got 41 students, and we've got, you know, so right now I'm really focused on doing that. And I really, really enjoy helping people out and passing on what knowledge I have to them. And then I can watch and see what they do with it. I'm really excited about doing that. I'm really excited to have our first class graduate and then be able to sit back and watch what those guys do. So,
awesome.
Yeah.
It is great. What would Ken Anderson now, you know, presently, 2017, say to a beginning rookie Ken Anderson?
Shut your mouth. That's... watch your mouth. Sometimes you have to just hold your tongue about certain things. I maybe wouldn't be as vocal publicly. I think there's a difference between saying stuff publicly and saying stuff to a person man to man. You know, if I got a problem with Vince or with the, you know, one of his particular, you know, the way that he's running his company or one of the rules or whatever, like instead of saying something about it on social media or in an interview like this, pulling him aside and saying, here's what I feel about this. You know, I think there's something to be said about that. But I mean, you know, I don't have a whole lot of regrets, and I kind of had not a hard upbringing, but I had problems just like everybody else did. Yeah. You know, I didn't grow up with my real father. I had a stepfather, and I didn't really like my stepfather and stuff. You know, until I got older, and he was really hard on me and verbally abusive and stuff. But like, I'm happy that happened. I'm not going to treat my kids that way. But I'm happy that all that happened because it made me who I am today. And that's my mistakes that I made in the WWE got me to where I am today too. And if that allows me to pull one of my students aside and say like, hey, shut up. You know, talk to me about it. Talk to your friends about it. Don't say anything about this or you know, prevent them from doing great harm to their careers. So be it.
Well, I can say so myself, with me being in media professionally for 4 years, we've done radio and radio studio, then we went to doing online. You always been a natural orator, talking, doing well with people, having a good voice, having good mic skills. You doing a podcast now, I would say, Fitz, you can see like everybody's doing a podcast now. It's, everybody's sisters, cousin, side chick, stepdad doing a podcast. Everybody doing a podcast now. Even people in the business. I'm on to say I'm cool with Jim Ross. Jim Ross has been on our show and definitely gave us great advice and enjoyed us. He was one of the first ones when we started 4 years ago. It was JR's podcast, Stone Cold and Jericho. And then you have Bischoff and Cornette and Lillian Garcia has won that. Russo has won. Your buddy of ours, Flair, had won. And everybody's having one now. You haven't won, though, Ken. I'm not just saying it because, you know, shout out to Chris Featherstone, our good mutual friend. You always been a natural. So you doing a podcast. What challenges do you think you have ahead since all the boys have won? All the girls have won.
Ric Flair.
Yeah. So that's a great question. And the thing is when I approached my co-host about doing a podcast, he sort of wrinkled his nose at me like, oh, another wrestling podcast? And I said, I don't want to talk about wrestling. We're not allowed to talk about wrestling. So, you know, all these people, the Austins and the Cornettes and Jerichos, and they've got the market pretty well cornered on wrestling. They got it hemmed up. So I generally... we talk about politics and religion and, you know, touchy subjects that are
who wants to touch
current in the news or something that's bothering me or bothering David, my co-host, when we talk about stuff like that. If I know that we agree about something, you know, say gay marriage, like we agree on that topic. So we bring in a Catholic priest who disagrees with us to sort of give his viewpoints and why he feels the way that he does and what, you know, what it is that he's experienced in his life or read or whatever that leads him to that conclusion. And we're not necessarily going to solve world hunger or, you know, create world peace, but I feel like the ability to have conversations like that with people that you disagree with, that's what we need to have more of, instead of just yelling at each other, talking at each other. Mm. So it's, if you don't mind, I'm going to pimp it here. It's called Push the Button, the podcast. And it's, you can find it on iTunes and Stitcher, or you can go to dvmpe.com and download it directly from there. So.
And like we do, we do talk wrestling, but that's like different. We spoke off air yesterday. We talk everything. We talk politics and TV and movies, and we've had guests on that's done movies, and there's anything, random news, crazy news. So yep. we expand, but we do talk wrestling. It's good to talk about it, but and I'm doing in my experience, talk to a lot of the boys. They love talking about other stuff. Like we see you guys on TV. It's wrestling, wrestling, wrestling. That's all. That's your life. So when you can talk about, hey, Marvel or DC, or hey, what do you think about Obama, sure. or what do you think about Taco Bell, or anything? What's your favorite superhero movie? Or Mickey Mouse? They like that, they definitely do. Yeah. So
that's great. I generally try to, and when I do have, do have guests from time to time who are friends of mine in the wrestling business. Like we've had MVP on a few times. I've had Vince Russo on, and you sort of break the mold for them because they're used to just talking wrestling, and we get to talk about other stuff. So I really enjoy it, and I think you guys should stick with that.
Yes,
the formula that you got.
Yes. Hey. If we let you go, it's 11 a.m. Friday, so it's the future for us. Ken Anderson there with Mrs. and his god dog. What's for breakfast? Mm-hmm. But this dinner time here.
Breakfast was
Lamb
chops, some lamb chops, and some potatoes from last night. Leftovers. It was delicious.
Saltine, what's for dinner? Ever since you point?
I fixed chili.
Oh, that's what's up.
Good. Spicy?
Oh, I love spicy chili. I didn't make it too spicy because I didn't want to...
chicken for me. I cook chicken like grilled chicken.
Eat it like that, but I'll put more spice in it.
Mashed potatoes. I love spicy cream beans. So,
you should rub them. Yeah, you should rub them. Give them the spicy chili.
Stop it.
Yeah.
So what'd you have for dinner?
I had some oven roasted chicken breast with some penne noodles and vegetables.
It better. It
and
better
Coca-Cola.
Be.
By the way, Coca-Cola.
Are you a Pepsi fan? Coke.
Are you a Pepsi fan, Ken?
Nope. If I'm gonna drink Coke, it's generally I drink Diet Coke. If I drink soda, Mountain Dew and Diet Coke are my probably two favorite.
I'm a Pepsi girl, but because my mom brings Cokes in the house, that's all I can drink right now. I really don't like them because it's too sweet for me.
It really is. I have a hard time finishing an entire can.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Shout out to RC Cola, too. Old school RC Cola.
Yeah.
Well,
Tab.
Tab.
Warm Tab. Tab was great for belching tests when I was a kid.
Oh, really? Okay.
It was always Pepsi for us.
Chug.
Pepsi's always got us belching around the house. So.
Yeah.
A lot of people can do Coca-Cola. Like, I had someone email me about like 50 things you can do with Coca-Cola besides drinking. Still good right. enough. What do you think? It would be kind of cool. Shout out to your twins. You know, maybe your little son one day had like a little microphone, you know, start imitating you. Does he imitate you at all?
No. they don't really watch. They don't really watch wrestling right now. But one day, Daivari was at my house, and he said, "Have your kids ever seen you wrestle?
Oh my goodness!
Do they know like you do stuff on TV?" And so, no, I don't think so. So they were putzing around with something, and we got it up on YouTube on the TV. It was like a picture of me or a video of me wrestling or coming out to the ring, something. And they couldn't be bothered. They were just like, "Hey, look, what's that? It's Daddy." Okay, back to the puzzle or whatever they were doing. So.
Oh, man. So hopefully your kids won't become Cowboys fans, because I know you being Green Bay, you're like, nope, not at all.
I'll disown them.
Oh, no.
No, I'm kidding. No.
Put them in hell in the cell. Kennedy's kids, hell in the cell. This is like it is here. You better not taunt us about being a Steeler fan.
I'm bigger than them, so.
Yes. Well, Ken Anderson, it's been an honor. What we do at the Ennis Club, the plug party, which you already start plugging your podcast. If you need to, you want to plug anything else that you're involved with, even on wrestling related, if there's any charities or any other projects, you or your girlfriend or your friends that's doing, you can go ahead and plug it.
Ooh. Yeah, I'd like to, you know, obviously the podcast, Push the Button on iTunes and Stitcher.
Yes, sir.
And again, and our wrestling school. If you know of somebody that is interested in becoming a professional wrestler, we have a fantastic facility. We train everybody from referees, if you want to be a referee, a manager, an announcer, or an actual wrestler, we train everybody. It's a very comprehensive program, and you know, we have a lot of what we do is video breakdown. We break down matches, and we've got a big widescreen, you know, movie theater. What's that? Oh yeah. But anyway, our website is theacademyprowrestling.com.
Okay.
Send us an email or call the number on there. Leave a text message. And you can follow me on Instagram as Mr. Ken Anderson, M-I-S-T-E-R, Ken Anderson. And on Twitter, it's Mr. Ken Anderson, just M-R Ken Anderson. So,
Ken Anderson, is Savage used to say, NWO, it's been an honor to have you on our show on a Skype edition. Saltine, any last words or ever since your queen?
No, it was wonderful to talk to you. It really was.
Yeah. Fantastic to talk to you guys. I appreciate it. You got a good thing going on, so please continue doing what you're doing.
Thank you. Maybe next time we can get the Salty Mutt to appear on the screen so you can meet
yeah, it's a big dog.
Yeah.
All right, Ken. Thank you much.
All right, guys. Hope
you have a good day, and we'll talk to you soon.
Talking to you.
You too. Good night, mates.
All right. Thank you. Good day.